Welcome to the Jay Alexis Show. My name is Jay Alexis. This is my show. We talk about things. I interview my friends. I interview people in the business. I people interview people out of the business. We talk things. We basically just talk. And this is my first show, so hopefully it goes well. But this won't be my last, so it's a learning progress as we move along. I'm very grateful to have my first guest on my show, Samuel Vecini. I hope I pronounced it correctly, but he is the director of the new movie, Violet. He just wrote and directed. He just finished it. He also did other short films, Breathless. Oh, crap. I just went blank on the other movies. But, you know, let me bring him on, and we'll talk about those movies as well. So, yeah, everyone, please welcome Samuel Vecini to my show.
Oh, that, you guys didn't have to clap for me. Oh, thanks, man. That's so nice. You already have a clapping ovation for the first episode? Holy crap.
I should. That's awesome. Yeah. yeah, did I say your name correctly? Is it Vecini?
It's Vecini.
Vecini. Oh, okay. Wow. That's.
Yeah, everyone doesn't know. Like, everyone, the last name is so hard to pronounce. It's cool.
Yeah. That happens a lot to me. Like, they'll just hear my name and like, how's it pronounced? And I'll pronounce it. And I was like, it's just the way it sounds. So, but I mean, it honestly doesn't bother me. Like, for me personally, Same. It doesn't bother me because I'm just like, it's cool. It's not like, you know, like I have other things to worry about in life. But I think if they do it intentionally, then I get upset.
Like, if you see Joe or Samuel, it's like so easy to say those names. If they try to like, then it'll be annoying. But the last ones are always messed up.
Yeah, it's just, it's really weird. I mean, like, for me, like, I'll ask people, like, hey, is this how it's pronounced, or is this how you say it? Like, I have a friend, he's from Mexico, and his name is spelled Martin, and it's, you know, pronounced as Martin. So when I met him, we were talking, and I go, hey, is your name pronounced Martin, or is it Martin? And, like, his face just lit up. He was like, you're the first person to actually pronounce it correctly since I've been here. I'm like, he was like, aside from my family, I was like, wow. So I felt like really honored. Like, I was like, like, I discovered, like, it's like our secret code. So, but yeah, so you did Breathless.
Breathe.
And there was also, I'm trying to think of the other one because I've seen them before.
Senses and Crazia were my other short films.
There you go. Yeah. I remember I met you. It was on a Facebook group, and it was just like, hey, you know, I did some short films, and I just started for House of Tortured Souls. Like, that's it was like I just first started, and I want to say you were just finishing your short films, or you just finished them, so you were kind of new to the scene. If that makes, like, if that is,
yeah,
that
was
appropriate
2018. I was just starting out filmmaking.
Yeah. So you were, I mean, you're still relatively young. Like, when I first saw you, I was just like, okay, like, I'm not trying to sound rude, but, like, when I first saw you, it was like, okay, he's, like, a young kid, you know, so. And I saw your films, I was like, holy shit, this is really, just really deep, just really, I mean, it was like, I mean, it was very deep. I mean, I had to say that word so loosely, but it was just something different. It was like a breath of fresh air. It was very poetic, very symbolic, a lot in your films. And I was just like, holy shit, and we got to talking. And you tell me about Violet. And I was just like, okay, I'm listening. And like, for the longest time, I think I had, like, the idea of what Violet was going to be. Like, when you told me and everything, I was like, okay, well, that's what, like, I expected something completely different. Like, I expected, like, typical action movie, typical revenge film, this and that. Like, I expected, you know, revenge, you know, just, you know, like a Hollywood film almost, mm-hmm. in that sense. And I remember I saw it, and it just blew me away. Like, I jumped on as producer, associate producer, and it was really cool because, you know, you're very confident, you know, you never said, hey, does this work, or should I do this, or, you know, what, like, it was never like, you were always, like, planned ahead with everything. And I guess my question is, how's been, like, the reaction so far For fans who've seen the movie finally, because I know there was a lot of talk about it.
I'm actually really happy of how people are like responding to it, because when I wrote the script back in 2017, and it's just been a story that like I've known inside, back, and out. Like I know the entire thing, so I don't know if you know. It's hard for me to view my work because like I'm not an outsider looking in. So actually getting a response from people being like, "Wow, they really like the twist," or they really like just the story in general of like how, you know, everything plays out. Like it really, like Steve Rasmussen, I think I said his last name right. Last name. Yeah. Man.
I mean, he was, like, he the can first tell me. Review.
So his response was looks great. Cause I think the best response though, honestly, was the people that watched my short films first and then watched the feature.
Yeah.
Cause they got to see me like in a very short amount of time, go from making short films, like not knowing what I'm doing really the best into doing something decent. So
yeah, because I remember there was times where I would see like work prints of Violet, and like you would show, like you were like, oh hey, this is what I'm working on so far, and it was like oh, this is really good. Like I would tell you, like, this is, I really love this, and like, no, it needs this, it needs this and that, and I was just like, but it's fine the way it is. But I mean, it shows that you're really dedicated to the art, where your first films I saw were like, well, these are good. And if you weren't happy with those, or if there was like room for improvement, then it shows in Violet, where everything was like to a T perfect, I guess. And I'm pretty sure you had your good days and bad days of filming. You know, like
a lot of bad ones.
Yeah, especially in independent filmmaking. It's I mean, it looks simple, but at the end of the day, it's very stressful. Like, I try to do films, and I try to direct, and this is before, I think, I want to say this is before the whole, like, Indigo or Kickstarter or anything like that. So basically, I was just, like, funding my own movies, like, just out of my own pocket, and if we had a bad day, it was, like, the worst day ever. So I can imagine it's, like, 10 times worse.
Oh, my God, yeah. I would just say that for right now. Stressful is in, like, money, for example. So, like, I pretty much produced – I produced the entire short films, all those.
Yeah.
The feature, I pretty much produced most of the feature myself. I had help from you, obviously, and some other people.
But,
like, Violet cost $20,000. And in total with the producers, I got like 3,000 from producers, so 17,000 came from me.
Yeah.
Wow. That's a lot of money, man. And I'm paying I'm paying that off at the moment. I had to get some credit cards to finish the movie. So money is the big thing about that. That's why it's stressful for filmmaking, because like when you're an indie guy, you're pretty much just buying time. You're getting the people you want, and you're making sure you have the time to do it. But then again, like you can't do like you know, you have 24 hours in a day, but really, like, film days are, like, 8 hours.
Yeah.
Like, there's only so much you can do in a day. So, like, I know, like, the minimum amount of days it takes for people to do feature films is, like, 10 days. And that's still, like, a lot of work in 10 days. So,
yeah. I know that, like, Rob Zombie, you know, love him or hate him, he can make a movie within 30 days. And I'll, like, see the documentaries, I'll see the behind the scenes. And the movies, you know, like, people, you know, you can have your opinion. But it's like, fuck, I mean, 30 days, that's like...
not a lot of time. That's not a lot of time.
And it's like, it's just... But you know what? I mean, did you ever, like... Yeah, it was stressful, and yeah, it was tiring, but were there days... Yeah, like, did you ever feel like this... It was like an adrenaline rush where you're like, fuck, this, like, I hate... I'm, like, so tired, I'm so annoyed, but I'm so happy with everything. Like, I'm just like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I will say this: the when we first started doing the shoot was in June. I was planning on shooting most of it in 1 week. Boy, was I wrong!
Yeah.
Boy, was I wrong! We got like 30% of the film done when I thought we were getting like 80-something%. So we got the Steve basement stuff done. We got a lot of big things done in that week, but that week was just really stressful. But then in August, when we were coming back, and this is when the credit cards were involved.
Yeah.
August stuff. That 4 days, man, it was like we did work, but like we were getting done on time, and it was so nice because we came back to my place and we played like Mario Kart and stuff.
Yeah.
It was just like we got the work done, and we also were able to actually like hang out and relax and have fun. Whereas in June, it was like 14-hour days. I would come home, SD cards would be corrupted, and I'm staying up to try to fix it, and then I have 3 hours of sleep, wake up again at like 9 in the morning, let's go film. It was constant, like, oh, it's bad.
Yeah, I mean, I can imagine, you know, and it's just, you know, was there ever a time where people would say, like, or, like, if you saw a scene either in editing or in final product where it looked very simple, the scene, but it was like the longest day, you know, to shoot? Did you ever, was there anything like that in the movie that you saw?
I'm trying to think. I know, like, the easiest, like, people would say, like, the easiest stuff would be, like, the one shot takes.
Yeah.
But really, like, those took longer than some of the other scenes. Like, I'm like thinking, like, when you said that, I'm thinking of my first short film, Senses.
Yeah.
I wanted to say that real quick, because like there was a very simple shot of my friend Jesse. Shout out Jesse, you might be listening to this.
Yeah.
She was trying to open the door, like the little hinging on the apartment door, like just unlock it and open the door. But she's not actually opening the door. She's like going to open it.
Yeah.
And she couldn't even do that, and it took like 30 minutes for her to get the one shot of her doing that. It took like 30 minutes to like an hour. It was so funny, because she couldn't open the door.
That has always been my number one question with anyone in the business, because it's just like, you know, when I'm far from being a filmmaker myself, but I've like done it, and there was like, yeah, it's like a simple scene, you know, character. I'm just using this for example. Character walks into his house, sits down. Okay, that's simple enough. And it could just be like lighting, it could be sound, it could be, you know, just camera. It could be, just so many things. And it's like, there goes the whole day. It's like, great, we took 8 hours for 30 seconds. And it's just like, like when someone sees it, it's like, oh, that doesn't look like it was a big deal. It's like, yeah, I hate that scene. You know, like, you'll just look back. And I remember I went to, it was, we had a Comic-Con here. I think it was called Alamo City Comic-Con. And I went to it. It was the first one, blah, 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 whatever. And, you know, it was the whole thing, like, oh, we're going to bring The Walking Dead, you know, blah, blah. And they had like a huge cast of The Walking Dead, and I felt really weird / bad, but they had one of the girls from Walking Dead. I think they had two of the young kids, and one of them was the girl who was the first zombie that Rick encounters in the episode. And I felt so bad for her, because she was just sitting there. Like, no one was talking to her. No one was, like, or anything. But I didn't want to feel like, you know, I didn't want to make her feel awkward. Because, you know, I'm a big guy. I'm, like, 6'1". So I didn't want to, like, terrify the poor girl. So I was like, I was by her table. And I was like, oh, hey, how's it going? Nice to meet you. Because I didn't want her to feel like, you know, wow, I'm just getting paid to sit here. But I guess that's not a bad thing. And I asked her, I was like, hey, you know, I asked the same question, like, how long did it take to do your scene versus the makeup that it took to be, you know, set up? And she was like, I think, like, the makeup was, like, 3 hours or something like that. And the whole shoot, that scene was just 8 hours. And I was like, wow. So, you know, and that's just usually my first question I ask a lot of people, because it's like, you know, it's like, I'm just curious, you know, because it's just one of those things where it's like, yeah, you know, this scene, that scene.
Like, I know for Walking Dead, that scene was all outside, so they probably had to fight the sun as well. And with that, like, they're trying to get good, like, lighting. They don't want anything, like, they don't want their shots overexposed, so they were trying to, like, play with the sun and see where they could put their, like, diffusers and stuff to get the best, like, quality. So just that stuff takes a while. And getting all your little shot, like, yeah, that probably did take a long time.
Yeah, like when I see like independent films that are take place in the woods or anything like that, and it's not on a set, I'm like, you poor souls. Oh my god. Like, yeah. it makes me feel bad. Like, fuck, like this, like
the
it just
bugs, the fucking sun, everything, man. Ugh,
it's annoying. Yeah, it's honestly a struggle, and it's little things like that can really affect a whole day. But you know, it's a good movie. You know, I liked Violet, and I'm not saying that because I worked on it or anything like that. It's because it's a really good movie.
Thank you.
I mean, if it was bad or anything, I'd say, well, you know, this, but you know, like, I would just like critique it, but I wouldn't bash you for it. You know what I mean?
Because I'm already bashing me. Because I already know, like, for me, I'm my worst critic. But that also shows in my work, like every film is better than the last because I always see what's wrong and I try to be better. But I'm not better just be like just to make a product. I always have stories to tell. I started out as a writer and I have all these stories that I want to like tell. So I'm just finally able to do it through film. So.
Do you now that it's finished, or all your other products are finished, do you ever look back at it now and think, well, I wanted to do this, or looking back, I could have just fixed this, or anything
Oh
like
my
that?
God, yes. There's so all my films, there's at least something I wish I could have done or, changed or tweaked or even in editing. Like I look back and I like since it's in a creation mostly, I wasn't the best editor back then and it shows. But like for Senses, for example, Senses is my first ever short film. I had no crew, it was just me doing sound and everything. I had my friend Tyler or my friend Matthew. I let them like hold the boom when sometimes I could hold the boom, but I had all the settings ready. I just told them like make sure like when I say action, can you just click the button for me? Like that's really what I told them because I just couldn't do that. It was too hard. But anyways, on Senses, for example, I didn't really know how to use my camera. It shows because like well, hopefully the footage doesn't look bad because like I use autofocus for the entire thing. And I kind of keep clicking on the screen to make sure it kept saying in focus.
I'm like it,
Like,
it's really like it, I know like I forget the camera I used when I try to make my movies or anything like that. It was just basically a simple camera, and it was this is before I think I had to use like tapes, and I forgot the kind of tapes we used. But they were like these little cassettes, like almost like a little mini Betamax, and you would just top them in and you just record it, and then you would have to like you would have to like keep it in the camera and then plug in a USB to a computer just to upload it. So it was like very frustrating. But I
that
mean,
does sound frustrating.
yeah, because I would have all like I would have a bag full of these tapes of footage. And I'm like, what's this? And I didn't label them because I was like, no, so I was just like, no, I'm good. I know which ones we did today. So I was just like, I guess we'll just upload everything and just kind of like make a meatloaf movie. So it never went through. I think for me, what sucked was that, well, it didn't suck, but it was just life, was that we had people who had daytime jobs, they had, families. And they weren't getting paid. So it was basically weekends like, hey, do you want to hang out and make a movie? And they wouldn't see one dime. Like, I didn't see anything. I was just like, hey, I'm not seeing money either. So, I mean, if I can make, a dollar, I'm happy. So, but I mean, it was a learning experience. And like, with I like your short films and they looked really good. But what helps is that I think you worked on other films beforehand. You worked with Scott, I think I'll pronounce it correct, Scott Schremer, or is it Schremer?
Schirmer, you got it right.
Schremer, yeah. So you worked with him. That was your first film that you worked on, correct? I think it was Batman.
Yeah, The Batman. We shot that in Michigan in January of 2018. I have a fun story to tell about that shoot, actually.
Yes, by all means.
So, a year before that, January of 2017, I was supposed to be on set for Space Babes. I was invited to be on set and help out and stuff. Just be there, be an extra, and I think the extra is when like Jason Crow gets pissed on or whatever, or like just the crowd when they're cheering. I think I was gonna be one of them, but this is when I didn't have a car, and I asked my brother if he could take me. You want to be in the movie with me? And he didn't do it. He looks back at it and he's like, "Shit, I should have done that, man. There's fucking strippers everywhere." But he didn't want to do it, so I couldn't be involved, and I was very sad. But I was able to work on The Batman. I told Scott like, "Hey, if you ever need anybody to help you out, just ask me. I'll come out." I love his films. He's my favorite filmmaker, and I'm a hard worker. So like, you tell me what to do, I'll do it. And he asked me like, "Hey, you want to come out to help us on The Batman?" And I have a place to sleep. He'd feed me, and I asked if I could get like an executive producer credit for helping.
That's cool.
Yeah, so I didn't get paid for it. I came out. He took care of me, and I helped make the movie. I was there for 6 days, 6, 7 days. I was there. Yeah, so yeah, it was really cool. So here's the funny story, though. So my car wasn't really that the best at the time.
Yeah.
I have a car now, but like it's not the best, where like my parents were scared if I drove I would like break down.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. I got a ride to Michigan. My father
Wow.
drove me to Michigan, and then he
Wow.
left me there, and
Yeah.
no, and my mom would not pick me up, and my dad would not pick me up. So I was literally, and I came from Illinois, so it was like a 4-hour drive to
Okay.
Michigan,
Yeah.
Columbiaville, Michigan. There's like, it's literally in the middle of nowhere.
Wow.
So I get there and I'm like, all right, I got to figure out what I'm gonna do to get back home in a week.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, that was the first step though. Like, I put myself in a situation I didn't know how to get out of, but I didn't really think about that. I thought about like being on set and just learning the film and just, you know, making a movie and seeing how it's all made. And
Right.
I just forgot about the whole car situation.
Yeah,
Yeah.
can be a
So I,
complete.
yeah. So yeah, I was on set and I talked to Samuel Thompson. He did a sound for me on Violet. I met him there. And he showed me how to like light, and he showed me how he did sound a bit. I was still new, and I was like thinking like, how does this all work?
Yeah.
But I was able to get the gist of how scenes were shot, because I was
Yeah.
like day to day, I helped with all the mansion stuff. So it was really cool. Just seeing how scheduling was, and how you wake up, and how like people do like just how to make a movie. It just Before that, I wanted to do a movie. I wanted to make short films and stuff. I just never knew how to. Like, I just never, like, I didn't know like how to take the first step, and that was
Yeah.
my first step, was being on that set. And then 2 weeks later, all right, I'll finish the story. So at the
Yeah,
end
because
of
I'm
the
like, I'm
week,
kind of like, well, how did he? Because obviously we're talking now, but it's like, so how did you get home?
So at the
But.
end of the week, literally the night before I was supposed to be going back, my cousin, she was free, and she's like, I'll come to Columbiaville, Michigan, and pick you up out of the blue. So I was like, cool.
Wow.
Yeah,
That's.
little last minute
Yeah.
pickup.
I mean, it's terrifying, like looking like in hindsight, but not the same part. It's like, yeah, but I mean, this is one of those stories you can tell your kids, like, well, you know,
Took a
I
risk and it paid
would
off.
exactly. I mean, that's part of the whole, you know, that's all about life. I mean, you just gotta take. I mean, you could either like, well, I didn't go, so I just sat home, and
I
blah
could
blah
have stayed
blah.
home. I could have been. I was working at a grocery store at the time. I could have
Yeah.
just stayed home and just went to work, but I decided to say fuck it, took the week off, and went.
I mean, that's the whole point of life, just taking a chance. You know, it could have been, you know, what, you know, versus just staying at working, like, yeah, it's cool, versus just learning the craft. And that's the cool thing is that a lot of people who tell you, oh, if you want to get into films, I mean, yeah, if you want to go to school, that's cool. You know, I'm not
You
arguing
don't have
about, you
to,
know,
though. That's only if you want to
yeah,
make connections. But, like,
exactly. I mean,
I've
if
already
you
made
want to.
so many connections already myself.
That's yeah, that's the thing. It's like if you want to go to school, that's cool. If not, that's cool. But a lot of people will tell you just fucking, you know, trial and error. Just go out there, grab a camera, grab your friends, and just make a film. A short film, long, you know, feature film. Just make a film and learn from it and keep on doing it until
And stay
you
under
know.
budget.
Yeah, and to the point where Hollywood's like, hey, you know what? Here's a truckload of money. Do whatever you want.
I
And, you
wish.
know. Yeah, I know, and it's just one of those things. I mean, looking back, like James Gunn, you know, Peter Jackson, I mean, they made, you know, these B movies and everything else, and now here they're making big blockbuster movies. So it's just like maybe independent directors are the go-to for making big budget films eventually. So
They make the best
that's
films, honestly.
they really do. I mean, I didn't care for King Kong from Peter Jackson, but I mean. I just love how James Gunn can go back to doing a family movie and then doing a horror movie. Like, Guardians of the
Oh,
Galaxy,
definitely.
great fucking movie. And then Brightburn, like, when he talked about it, I was just like, okay. But then, you know, when I saw it, I was like, wow, this is basically Man of Steel, but as a horror movie. And it's a great fucking movie. Like, holy shit. I mean, it's just, you know. It's just so good, and I love how he's so versatile with his work that he can go back and forth like that, and that's just like so
Especially
cool.
how he
Yeah,
started with Trauma
completely.
and then he like moved up.
Exactly. I forgot about that. I know he did. He did Romeo and Juliet, and he also did Citizen Toxie, which was really fucking goofy, but it's so fun. But do you ever see yourself, like, could you, like, if you had a chance, would you do, like, if you had to do your dream project, what would your dream project be? Like,
My dream project would probably be my novel. I would like to
yeah.
turn that into like a mini series. This is a huge fucking
Really?
story. I don't see it being a movie because it's just a huge story. It's kind of like it has to be in like episodes, you know, like the way I wrote it, there's always cliffhangers and there's always some
Yeah.
extra to come up and new twists and turns of the story. So it would have to be like a mini series, like a
Yeah.
limited time thing, like, oh, there's like 8 episodes or something, you know.
Yeah, that seems to be the go-to for a lot of people nowadays. It's just like, hey, turn it into a TV series, or hey, turn it into a limited series, which is honestly, I think, the best route because, I mean, Hannibal, I don't know if you ever saw that. That's a great fucking TV
See,
series.
I didn't see that one, but I know people were talking about it, and it looked interesting.
It's so fucking good. Like, I love my favorite thing about the show was that every season finale is just fucking cuckoo bananas, off the wall gore. And they would say, yeah, we thought we were gonna be canceled, so we said, fuck it, let's just do whatever the fuck we want, and we got away with it. And if you watch the first two seasons, the season like season two has just is just basically a bloodbath, and I'm like, holy shit. And they would say, yeah, we thought we were gonna get canceled,
Didn't
so
it
we
get
would just do
canceled?
whatever. It did, and
Well, we
it,
got
yeah, I think
canceled.
season. Yeah, season three was the final season, but it ended like from what I still haven't seen it because it's one of those things where I don't want to finish it because then it's over. So as long as I haven't finished season three, then I could still like keep it alive if that makes any damn sense.
I get it.
But
Game of Thrones.
yeah, and they canceled it, but the way they ended it was like it was everyone was really happy with it, like they were really pleased with it, and I tried to watch.
I noticed with Netflix, they've been canceling shows after like 3 seasons usually now.
Yeah, it's really weird. Like, oh, everyone loves it. Great, we're gonna cancel it. And I really hate that. I'm like, ugh. Like it just and there's really no like I haven't really heard a logical reason. Like, oh well, budget cuts or oh we had the actors couldn't agree to it, so they're just so tied up with their schedules that we can't do it or whatever. It's just like no, it's over, and it really sucks because there's been a lot of good stuff on there. And it's like, really?
I don't
And
think
even.
Netflix can afford it actually, 'cause I think after 3 seasons, the actors or people working on it will like want a raise or something, and then Netflix is like, all right, nope, we're not gonna pay it. I think that's
Yeah,
what's
that
going
makes a
on.
lot of
But
sense
I understand
because it's just.
Stranger Things, because Stranger Things is like the biggest show on their like thing, so they're gonna keep that alive.
I
But
think. I've heard they're gonna stop at season four. Like I think season that's what I've heard that after season four, that's it. Which kind of makes sense because they're growing up. And it's just, I don't think they can. Like after a while, they're like, well, they're not really kids anymore, and it's gonna lose that charm of them, like the whole,
teenagers now.
80s. Yeah. So I mean, after a while, it's like, well, I mean, it could only be the 80s for so long. So I
Stranger
mean, they can't.
Things season 26.
Yeah, and it's still 1984. It's like, all right, guys, by now they should be like, way past their prime. They should be like adults by now, or just it should be the 90s or the early 2000s. And yeah, it's just, it's, I mean, but I mean, if you could tell a story and end it, that's great. Like, I couldn't, I know for me, I stopped Orange is the New Black after a while. And I was just like, okay. And I think for me, it's just that everyone either, I think what I hate the most is that people will tell me, like, oh, you're not watching it, you gotta watch this show. And I'm like, now it's becoming homework for me. Like, my ex, would constantly get on me if I didn't watch Game of Thrones, and she would be like, "Oh, you gotta watch it." I'm like, "Yeah, I'll watch it, but I mean, I gotta be in the mood to watch it." And she really loved it, like she was a big fan of it, and I tried several times, and I just could not get into it for the life of
Yeah,
me,
the first
and.
season's really hard to get into, but once you get through the first season, it's like really good. But then, once you get to season six, season six is
Yeah.
decent, but then it kind of goes downhill. Yeah.
That I think that's what worries me the most is about TV shows is that you invest in them and then they're like, oh, this is so good, but it's gonna suck. And I really hate that mentality that I
Yeah.
carry. Like I'm watching Barry and it's such a good fucking show. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's so fucking good. And I'm just like, please don't suck. Like, just please don't suck. I
Fingers
really am,
crossed.
you know. Yeah, because like with Dexter, that was a huge slap to fans. And I really hated that. Like, I was just like, ugh. So, you know, and it's just one of those things. Like, some shows work, some shows don't. So I think with streaming nowadays, that's really helping people, you know, get into shows, especially when they put it all. But I
Yeah.
think what I hate the most is that they'll make memes of it. So I vicariously watch it through their memes. I'm like, great, now I can't enjoy it. So that kind of
I
sucks.
will say something good though about shows. So I've been watching The Walking Dead since like season 2 on TV every week,
Okay.
and it's a weekly ritual thing. Me and my dad, we always meet up. We watch the new episode of Walking Dead. It's something we do every weekend. And I will say this though, The Walking Dead has not been the best show for a while.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, season 8 was the worst season ever. I fucking hated that so much. Like, every episode was dog shit in my opinion.
Yeah.
But season 9 completely like reinvented the show,
Yeah.
and like I am like the hugest Walking Dead fan again, because 9 and 10 are so good. Like, I even told people, if you're trying to get into Walking Dead, you can just go start watching season 9. Don't watch the other seasons. Like, you can completely just
Yeah.
ignore what happened and just watch season 9, because it's like a new beginning, you know? It's like a
Yeah.
new show. Because I don't want them to sit through season 8. Like, season, like, s the first few se like, I guess season 3 through 6
Yeah.
or 7, like, they're good seasons, but like they have their moments. Like, they are kind of slow at times, like really slow, and you have to wait for like the end of the episode for something to happen.
Yeah.
Whereas the new season 9 and 10, like, main characters can die in like any episode, and it's crazy. Like, it's not like back then when like the other seasons, it's like, oh, every mid-season finale or every finale, some big character's gonna die.
Yeah.
And now in this show, that doesn't happen. It's like, I don't want to say, I'm not gonna say spoiler, but like, there's an episode in season 9 that's completely fucking shocked the fuck out of me, even though I knew it was coming.
Yeah.
Like, it was like so, because they build you up and they like make you fall in love with people, and then they just rip your heart out. And
Yeah.
just become so depressed.
That's how it is. That's how it is being a Doctor Who fan. Like, I still watch that show. I think I shit. Well, the good thing about Doctor Who is that you can pretty much pick up with practically any Doctor with their season. And I kind of been behind on the past Doctor, and it's just one of those things where it's just like, and I think for me, I just enjoy binge watching. Like, for the most shows, like, all right, I'm just gonna binge watch this, like, just spend a day and just binge watch it, and just like
Oh,
call it a
true.
weekend. And I can't. I mean, I probably might check out Walking Dead, but I'm just not like a big Walking Dead fan anymore. I think I stopped when, oh shit, I think I stopped when. And you can honestly correct me, or anyone can correct me if you're listening, because
I'll
I'm all
probably
over
correct
to it.
you.
Is I think when they went to Alexandria,
Season 5?
that I think so. It was when they went to that camp where they thought they were going to be safe, but it turns out
Yep.
there were cannibals.
Season 5.
And the camp, yeah, okay. And like I was like, oh shit, they're fucking assholes. But when you see their point, you're like,
Well, like
well,
cannibals, yeah. And like they put
it's
them in a train
like.
car.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, I can kind of agree to a point, but it's still wrong, you know. Like, I get it, but at the same time, you know, it's like, like, I'm not saying, oh, like, good for them, but I mean, they have a lot of trust issues for anyone who hasn't seen it. And but I think that's where I stopped. I was just like, oh, okay, and that was it. And it's
I will say
just
this now
like.
though, to get you very interested in the show, in season 9, the new enemy is they're called the Whisperers,
Yeah.
and they wear the skin of like people. Like, they blend in as the walkers. So like, you could be
Yeah.
walking around, you think there's zombies out in the distance. There could be people with the zombies, you know, like just walking with them, and they
Yeah.
can like fucking stab you and shit. It's creepy as fuck. It
Yeah.
is really cool. And like, 'cause like those people, they're acting like animals. They're not like real people anymore. They're like animals, and like, it's so awesome.
Yeah. I gotta watch that. Like, I know when I see people wear masks in movies or something like that, it gets under my skin because I remember for one Halloween, a few Halloweens, I dressed as Leatherface, and the mask I have, it's just ungodly hot. Like I can wear it for maybe a few seconds, and I'm like, all
Oh
right, I
no.
want to take this off. So
You're sweating and you just can't breathe.
yeah, so it's just like when I see stuff like that, I'm just like, oh, those poor souls. Like I remember that I hear stories because I love Texas Chainsaw Massacre. That's like one of my all-time favorite movies, next to Spider Baby. And I've heard so many horror stories about that movie, and I'm just like, not so much like the movie itself, but just the
Shooting
behind
it.
the scene. Yeah, the shooting. Like it was just like the dinner scene. I think that's where my question came from, was when they said the dinner scene was like the worst thing they ever had to shoot. Like everyone was just pissed off, they were angry. They're like, you have no idea. That scene was just hell on earth to shoot. And when you look back at it, when you look at it as a filmmaker, you think, yeah, like God almighty, that must have been like a hellhole. Because this is, out of the woods, no AC, just
Yeah.
lights everywhere. And if you never worked on the set, lighting, it can
It's
get
hot.
really, yeah. So what we did is that I don't know if you've done this before or if you maybe it's different now because I'm older, but when we shot films, we used wax paper or parched paper
Yep.
to like not get it so hot because there were times where like because beforehand, the actors or the actresses would be like, can we take a 5 minute break? I need some water because I'm like really sweating over here. Like, yeah, we'll do that. So we started doing that. And it really works. It's cheap. You just go to a store, you just buy any wax paper, parchment paper, and just buy the fucking biggest roll you can, and you're good for like God knows how long.
See, that's what I
And
do. I put parchment paper over my lights. It acts as like a diffusion. So like it kind of like it's just so nice, man.
It is. I mean, there's like so many little tricks that I did. Like for the boom mic, we used a broom handle. And we
DIY
taped,
projects.
yeah, we taped the mic to the broom handle or to like a pole or anything we could find, and we used that. And what we did was that if the actors weren't in the scene, they're like, all right, you're gonna reuse the fucking mic or you're gonna do camera work. It was always something like, hey, you're gonna like just work, so don't expect to like, sit around all day. So we took it to our advantage, and it was really helpful at times. So that saved me a lot of
Damn,
money. Yeah.
you had a
So,
crew. I didn't have a crew.
well, it was mostly like, I mean, if you were an actor, you're like, all right. If you couldn't act, you're like, all right, you're going to hold the fucking camera. Which reminds me, there's a funny story I got to tell because it's very important to clarify things in movies. I remember I made a zombie, I wrote a zombie movie ages ago. And, my friend read it. And she goes, oh my God, you should make this into a movie. And I was just like, well, I don't know. It's just not my thing. Like, I was just like, I don't know. Like, I don't know if I could do it. Because, and
Stop.
so, yeah, so we did it. We set up the auditions and everything. And what happened was that, I said, oh, hey, it's a very graphic horror movie. It's a zombie movie, blah, blah. Like, basically, I saw the movie. But I didn't explain any. I was like, hey, it's rated R, there's language, there's violence, blah, blah, blah. And I remember they're like, oh, this auditions are this day, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, okay. And I would get emails from people saying, hey, I want an audition, blah, blah, blah. Like, yeah, come on by, it's gonna be fun, please, blah, And I was just more in so interested in the people who wanted to apply. So I was like, okay, cool. The day of the shoot, I get down there, and all these young kids are there, like just fucking like kids, teenagers, tweens, and I'm like, what's going on? Like this is what I do. So I'm sorry, real quick. So when I have to do auditions, I will go out and drink the night before, and blame my hangover on the bad acting. So I would be like, oh, I'm sorry, like, I'm not mad at you. I'm just tired because I drank less now, so I'm nervous. And it was just, yeah, and it was honestly, it's just my way of saying, hey, I don't want to be mean to you, so if I sound annoyed, it's because I'm hungover. And they're like, oh, yeah, it's okay, don't worry. So I'm like, oh, thank God. Because I hate being the bearer of bad news.
To their face, right?
Exactly, because, I mean, this is like an independent movie, so it's like, anyone who can help, that's a godsend. Like, oh, thank God, like, oh, yeah, I know how to do camera work. Oh, my God, you're hired. I don't care, you know, if you did one movie, you're hired. So it was just, you know, anything you can get was a godsend in independent films, especially for myself. So, definitely. And they were like, oh, we're here for the movie. And I'm like, what movie? And they're like, oh, blah, blah, blah. They said the Talon movie. And I was like, oh, you gotta be fucking kidding me. So it was all these kids auditioning for my rated R movie. And I was just like, okay. And, you know, I didn't want to tell them, like, all right, everyone go the fuck home. Like, this is, no, you're not, you're, you know, I was like, you know what? They came down here. I don't know where they, you know, they came down here. They drove down here. I don't give a shit. I want to audition them because, you know what? I mean, it's the least I can do. You know, I don't want to waste their time. And I'm already down here, so I'm just going to, you know, audition them. And they weren't bad. They weren't bad. It's just they were... You know, it was, yeah, they were young. It was like, no, this is a rated R movie. Like, I understand, you know, your parents wanted to get you in the business, but this is not for you. Maybe in another time in life, you know, blah, blah. And it's very important to clarify the age range for movies because you will get fucking kids to your movies. And it's like, no, I'm sorry. This is way too much for you, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
So... But my question is, I guess.
Oh, a question?
Yeah, there's a question. You know, I do have to ask questions on here sometimes. Is your family supportive of the work you've been doing? Or they're like, have they seen any of it? Or they're like, well, you know, like our son does movies, you know?
I'll say this. They, 50-50, I know when I first started doing it, they weren't really supportive of it. They're like, oh, that's cool, but
yeah,
they thought it might have been like a come and go thing, like, oh, he's doing this one day, he might go do this other thing the other day or something. They probably didn't think I was going to be doing it like constantly. But like, you know, when the film came out, like, oh, look, this is what my son did, blah blah blah, they were all very supportive. But then like the short films, especially if they knew I was putting money into my projects, they'd question that. They'd be like, you know, they weren't happy that I was investing in myself or so. They, like, at first my mom was telling me I should sell my first short film Senses, make money off of that. Like, she wanted me to make profits before I continued making films. But then it's like, I can't make profits because they're short films and I know it's not going to make much money. And I'm not really in it for the money. I just wanted to keep making films. So like, my mom is more of the business side of things. She's more of, she wants to make sure like I'm making money out of this and not losing money. But I have to keep telling her, like, starting out, you're gonna lose money. You have to just do it until people know who you are and they know that you're actually in it to make stuff for real, and then they'll help you. So I think she's finally understanding that now. I think he was being supportive in the short films. Like, I don't think he really liked them because they weren't really his cup of tea. But once the feature was done, he really loved it. He really liked the feature. So, you know.
Yeah, that's really cool because I know a lot of parents, you know, and I understand where they're coming from, but they have to understand, until Hollywood starts, like, paying everything, then at this point I'm pretty much, you know, eating ramen and just, like, wearing the same shirt I've been wearing for the last few years again. And it's just, it's heartbreaking because in the business, you have to accept criticism and you got to accept the fact, hey, you're going to be broke. Like, you're going to literally be a starving artist.
I got to say something about that. So in 2018, when I was doing my short films.
Yeah.
Literally, man, I experienced that because I worked at a grocery store, for example.
Yeah.
And I made like $10 an hour.
I didn't
get much money. I got maybe like 30 hours a week, which you know, so after taxes is like $200 something a week or something.
Yeah.
So, like, I would be working at this grocery store, and I would not buy lunch because I'm saving my money. So, and I'm so stupid. I don't eat breakfast in the morning, and I forget to pack lunches. So I'd go to work 9 to 5, starving my ass off, and then I get home and I'm eating dinner and stuff. I'm like, thank God, I have fucking food. But it was bad because like that was when I started doing full time and stuff. It was like I was always so hungry, and some days I'm like, fuck it, I'm buying food. But like most days I couldn't because I'm like, I have to do this, I have to do that. And with not a lot of money, it's like $200 a week wasn't much because I was paying off like credit cards and stuff at the time too. And like, I wanted to keep making movies. So for me, I was so happy that I was able, like my friends and stuff, I didn't have to pay them really. Like the for Senses, nobody got paid, but I think I gave them all a free copy of the film, like the special. I made a special edition of Senses with like Joe Meredith's artwork that like it was like
Oh
15
God,
of
I
them to
love
pay.
his. I'm sorry.
I think like yeah, it was great artwork. It's in the sleeve if you open up your Senses copy. It's like there. That was the cover art, and they have a special copy of it. So like I thanked them and they helped me make my first film, but I couldn't do too much, you know. But on Acrasia, I paid my main actor. I gave him like what like $60 or something. It was something like
No,
that.
that's not bad.
And then
I
my
mean,
sound guy, I gave him two cases of Mountain Dew because he wanted that. He liked Baja Blast, so I gave him some cases of Mountain Dew. He loved it. And then Jessie, I actually was going to offer her like a lot more, but she completely turned down my money. She just wanted to help me, so I really appreciate that.
That's really awesome. I know, like, I wish I could have paid some of my actors, but I'm like, well, I have no money. But there was just some like, oh, I want to work with you again. Like, I want to like promote you and like I want to help you. And that's the really cool thing is that there's a lot of labor of love, and you build friendships and you can build connections. And you know,
Yeah, if you
like you
treat them
say,
right,
Joe.
they'll want to keep working with you, so.
Exactly. Like it's one of those things where one of my favorite movies, Nothing But Trouble, like it's financially it was a failure to the studio, but overall it is considered one of the best films that the cast and crew got to work on. And they said that Dan Aykroyd was like a saint to everyone. He was like from what I heard was that he was basically like the guy, everyone's favorite person. Like he wasn't your boss, he was your best friend. And it was kind of like heartbreaking because he didn't believe in himself. He was like, you know what, this is gonna suck. And a lot of people are like, no, like you're really doing everything perfect. Like you are like the best person we've worked with so far. So that was really cool. And you know, it just helps because you build connections, you learn, and you grow and become friends. And like you were saying, Joe Meredith, I fucking love his work. Like his
Same.
work alone is like just like, oh my God, like fucking
He impresses the fuck out of me.
he is like his artwork, his work. It's just like seriously, studios fucking like just like I
Pick
want
him
to
up.
mail us. I want to mail a studio. Hey, this isn't my movie, but seriously, just fucking like just watch this.
Fun fact about Joe
And
Meredith, I messaged him like back in 2017. This is when I was gonna do a second book of, but my this was a collection of my horror novellas, and I have one copy of myself left. I finally kept a copy to myself, but I was gonna do a second book of horror novellas, which the first story was gonna be Senses because I didn't know if I was gonna make that into a short film. So hey, that's there. The one of them I never wrote, but I did use the title Inviolate. So the movie she's auditioning to is A Nightmare in Lucid Dreams. So I took the title, I threw it in Violet, like a little Easter egg for me only, because only I know it. And then Violet was gonna be called Starburn in the horror novella. So like I was thinking about just writing that book, and I contacted Joe about doing the cover art because I had Eric Wilson do the cover art for my first book, and I really loved Joe's artwork. And but then after a while, after I did the Batman and stuff, I knew I stopped writing because like I'd rather write screenplays because then I can actually like make a film out of it. Whereas
Yeah.
if I write a book, like a novel, I've written so many stories that nobody ever reads. It's kind of
Yeah.
pointless because like I spent like 5 years writing my first novel and nobody like ever read it. So like it was just pointless of spending all this time into something and it's just nothing, like no one cares. So I didn't care about that. And so I contacted Joe again and we became friends after this, and he did the artwork for Senses, obviously, the cool Skull Boy. But then
Yeah.
after that, I found out he actually, like for South Mill District, he did the entire score by himself. Like,
Yeah.
holy shit, he could do artwork, he can score, he made the entire film, he edited it, shot it, like he did everything on his film, and he also acted in it. Like, holy crap, that's impressive.
He's
And
basically a carpenter. Like he's
exactly.
basically a John Carpenter.
He's awesome. And he gave me a tongue prop for free. He sent me that to me. And
That's awesome.
he also did the music for Crazia for me because I
Yeah.
loved his style. So I was like, wow, this is my first time getting custom music. And it was amazing. He did it all on his iPad, which is crazy.
I mean, it's just, I mean, he is like, for lack of a better term, a monster with his work. I mean, it's just like, holy shit. Like, I know he did, like, there's been artwork that I've seen. It's, oh, this is really fucking good. And I remember one that stood out the most, and I actually messaged him. I was like, "You gotta write either a comic. You gotta start doing comic book work, or like cover art, or just come out with a book of your like prints. Like seriously, go and buy it." But he did
Same.
a picture of the coronavirus,
I saw
and
that. Yeah, I saw that.
yeah, and I was just like, "If you're for the people who are listening, if you get a chance, please follow Joe Meredith on Facebook or Instagram, like wherever he is. Just follow him. Follow his work. I
I think
swear."
his store envy is storeenvy.com/JoeMeredithArt. Look that up.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, just Google Joe Meredith. Like, seriously, you're not gonna be disappointed. But like, when I
And
saw it, I was
variants.
like, yeah.
I've seen some
And
behind the scenes of that movie, some early clips, and holy shit, it looks so good.
yeah, and I'm just like, fuck. And I remember that I saw his coronavirus picture, and I'm like, I want to hate this, but I love it because I'm just so pissed off about everything, and it sucks. And like, that's one of the ask you, and I'm pretty sure it has affected you, but with the whole coronavirus, has that been affecting work? Has that,
Yes.
like, how has how like explain to me what it's affected you, either if you want to talk about personally or just like work or whatever.
It affects me both ways. So I'm currently unemployed. I've been unemployed since March 11th or 12th, since it started. So it's been a month now, and I've just been home, and like it's fine. Like I've literally been unemployed this entire year. Like I had a job for like 2 weeks, and then the coronavirus hit, so I've pretty much just been jobless all year so far. And like I'm used to just staying at home now because it's been a month, but like I have something lined up at the end of this month, so that's cool. But my plan was we were going to shoot some early scenes for Scarlet April 26, and that was going to be the dorm room scenes. There's a few dorm room scenes because that's the only location I don't actually own, that like someone else, I have to like listen to their rules or try to figure out if I can get to their location, if they can, I have to like play with them. I can't just schedule it and then go to a location where I own. So it kind of sucks. So I was planning to do those scenes, and the coronavirus hit, so the schools got shut down till the fall, so I can't shoot those scenes until like the fall, which is in like 6 months.
I
So
know.
since that happened, I was like, I'm just gonna wait. So all of my plan, like I was gonna shoot the early scenes and then try to do a crowdfunding in like May or June, but now I can't do that. So all of it's gonna be delayed till end of the year, which honestly, at first I was very disappointed. Sorry if my dog's barking; she's annoying.
Oh no. She's the your dog is just translating for other dogs, so.
Thank you. So I was the dog just threw me off my game. My God.
So, but you were saying about that whole you were supposed to shoot in April, but then the
But
coronavirus, now it
yeah.
looks like the
So
fall. Yeah.
So all of my plans pretty much got changed, and honestly, like it's kind of good, better. It's good. It's for the better because like I was able to like look back, and I was able to cut my whole budget in half. So like the next film was gonna be cheap,
Yeah.
which it's not gonna like no decrease in quality. I was just able to figure out how to like actually make it where I can do it for like 6 to 7 thousand, which
Yeah.
really isn't a lot of money for films compared to the other one. So I'm pretty excited for that, and you know, it kind of sucks I have to wait, but I honestly have been like enjoying my time off. The last 2 weeks especially, all my friends, like my friend Tyler, he's a Marine. He came back to the States finally. So like
Yeah.
he's on our time. But before he was 8 hours ahead, so we never
Yeah.
got to like talk to him. But now all of my friends are on Xbox and stuff. We're always talking to each other. We're always playing games together. I wake up, they're fucking online, and like we just get on and like I've been it's like a summer vacation, you know, like everyone's home. We're all able to just like relax and just hang out. I've been playing a lot of Animal Crossing. you know, it's been
My
kind of nice.
brother recently got Animal Crossing, and it's like I talked to my friends who are all into it, and I was like, so what's the point of the game? And they were like, well, basically it's like Grand Theft Auto, but with animals, and there's no violence. I was like, okay.
Yeah,
I'm
you pretty
like,
much just like build your island, you know. You kind of just like it's a lot of grinding where you like go around, you cut trees, you get wood, you make
yeah.
items, you craft a lot. You're just trying to make like your island, you're trying to make your house. You're just trying to like make it look pretty and stuff. And it's very addicting.
Yeah.
Like, and what I love about it though, what I love is like the real time thing. All right, so you can get on your Animal Crossing, it's daytime, but like
Yeah.
in real time, like if it's 6 p.m. in real time, like if outside, if the sun's going down, your sun's going down in the game. So if you get on your game at like 9 p.m. at night, it's gonna be dark in your game, which is
Wow,
so cool.
that's
Plus,
really fucking cool. Like that,
the seasons change too. So if it's like winter, it's gonna be snowing, which is awesome. So.
yeah. That's really fucking cool. Like that, I love that, because what's funny was that, I can't really argue, because when I played Grand Theft Auto, was it four or five? This is how long I've been behind. No, I played it. It was five. Yeah, it was five. And one thing I would fucking do is that after I beat the game so many times, I would just drive around the whole city. Like I would just like listen to the music and just drive around.
That's relaxing.
Yeah, and it's just like now the more than ever, it's like fuck, I should do that again now, since I'm stuck inside. And I mean, it really doesn't bother me. Like I'm kind of a homebody myself, so I'm just like okay, but I miss little things. But from what I hear,
Movie
Animal
theaters.
Crossing, yeah, movie theaters. Oh my God, it's so fucking weird. Like I tell people, oh, when this is over, I'm gonna fucking go out to movie theaters and just sit in a dark room and watch a movie again that I do kind of at home.
It's
And
just
so
like a
people are like,
better experience. It's like a huge screen. It's just a great sound. I don't know. Just the experience of going to the movies. Like, I don't want it to go away, man. Because like now the whole Vudu thing. Yeah, you have the home experience. Like the new movies are now available to like watch and stuff. And like it's cool.
yeah.
I think it's a great idea. But I hope like when the movie theaters come back,
Yeah.
I don't want these to still be on Vudu because like then nobody will go to the movie theaters and I don't want them to die. So.
Exactly. Like, I mean, yeah, I get it. It's nice to be at home and watch movies, but at the same time, yeah, the movie theater is like just like the best experience ever. Like, I love the Alamo Draft House. Like, my favorite part is just to go there, watch the pre-shows, and then just go right into the movie.
Yeah, and there's
And
some of them
it's
you can actually get like food delivered, like not delivered to you, but like you sit down, you get some food, you watch a movie, you know, like those are so great.
I know that's my favorite thing, because I'm just like, because for me, it's just like some places, for the most part, I'm like the biggest popcorn fan ever. Like I will go to like a fucking theater, all right, let me just get popcorn, and I'm happy with that. So that's what I love the most, and it's just you can't beat it. I mean, it's just nice. I mean, theater. I mean, oh God, it's just. The theater, that's the best place ever, and it's so cool. It's just, I guess, growing up as a movie fan, it was like my sanctuary. It was like there was nothing that could beat it, and it's it'll be real. And like when I pass by it sometimes now, when I have to go to the store, I'll pass by a movie theater. I'm like, oh, patience, my pet. So,
yeah.
But
Hopefully
you
this
know,
lockdown doesn't take too long. But then again, I think there's still people going outside and not following the rules. So it might be, you know, pushed to like May 30th, maybe. You never know.
Yeah.
I hope not.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
everything is like right now for me. Like I told you about Walking Dead, they can't finish post-production on the last episode of the season because of the coronavirus, and it's pissing me off because like it's such a huge cliffhanger, and I want that episode, but I can't have it.
Yeah, like I'm just to the point where, like, I know that's what they did for Barry. Like they couldn't finish Barry because of the whole like they haven't started Barry season 3 yet because of the coronavirus. So I'm just like, can you guys just do a table read? Like, can you just like have all the actors do the table read, and then we just shoot the season later? Because it's just because if the season 2 had such, it was like a cliffhanger. It's a cliffhanger slash like what the fuck moment, and it was like. Like I don't want to spoil it, but it's there was one episode that I loved where it was it was basically he had a kid he tried to kidnap somebody and it ended so badly for everyone and he ends up winning at the end, but it's such a great episode and it's so intense like the whole time, like the first opening sequence you're like holy shit and it's like I think it lasts like 10 minutes. And then it keeps on going for the whole, like, 20 minutes of the show. And you're like, holy fuck, this is, like, it's a great show. Like, honestly, I would recommend it. Like, you would love it. It's dark, it's funny, it's violent. And Bill Hader is just so, he's so, like, he's very different. Like, it's almost like if they got Dexter right, you know? And but I mean, yeah, I mean, it's affecting a lot of people. I think more so the independent directors,
more so the film industry, because you need to be all together to make the movies and stuff. And it's just, I feel bad for, I know a lot of people that are my friends who are in the film industry and they cannot work at all. And I don't know if they're getting any stimulus checks or anything because they're technically freelancers. So
yeah.
I don't know. Like
It's a tough time, and I really hope we make, because, I mean, independent movies, big studios, I mean, everyone's feeling the pinch on this, so it's not like just a few people. This is like the world is being pinched by this. Yeah. But, I mean, with this time frame, do you feel that, you know, like, well, I'm not trying to put you down as a writer or director, time frame that you have, do you feel that this helps you craft Scarlet a little bit more to the point where, like, you know what?
Well, you can always tweak your script. I mean, for me, I began writing Scarlet in 2015, so it's been 5 years now, and I feel like it's very, like, I'm so happy with how it is, and I just want to do it. But I know, like, there's a few things I could probably tweak a little bit, but to be honest, like, you're always going to be working out, like, the movie forms while you're making it. Like for me with Violet, if you read the script, you have the script, it's completely different almost from the movie in some areas. Like a lot of scenes I'm like, wait, we can actually do this with the scene. Or like I know a lot of it, like I changed visuals and like I cut a lot of things out because I'm like, that doesn't have to be in the fucking movie. Like in the editing room or even just shooting the movie, you know, like what works and what doesn't work, and you're like, that does not work anymore. Or you're just thinking like, no, this could be better. And it just, the movie, you're always improving even if you think you have a finished script, you don't. Like, you're going to keep working on it even till it's done. Like, for me, for example, all the lake scenes with Violet by herself, there's a lot of visuals in the scenes, like just little things, whereas there's voiceover in the background. But in the script, the voiceover kind of took over the scene where you don't really have anything going on. She's just at the lake again. Yeah. But I was able to write in little, like, visuals, like, she's, like, drawing a house, or she's drawing the star, you know, or she's looking at the bench where her and Josh were sitting, like, just little things, and, like, that scene right there, the whole, she looks at the benches where Josh and her were sitting, and then she leaves the knife there, and she leaves, that was all, like, that's a great visual, like, she's done with what she's doing, so, like, I came up with that all as we were filming, so the script is really different, and, like, there is a few things I wish we could have shot differently. like, for example, like, but then again, we can't. I don't want to spoil anything for people, but one of the last scenes with the last, like, kill, I guess you would say it. I'm not going to say who it was, but the actor, he had a bad leg, so we can only, like, push him down once. And that initial was going to be a little bit – I could have had more angles and more time to do things, but because we can only do it once – and it was like midnight, and we were all tired. It was like the last scene for the week of June. We were all exhausted, so we had to figure out how to do it, and also not hurt him.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's why there's cutting ins and outs with the cigarette. But the cigarette was always in the script, I think, of like his life burning away. But I was able to do it. But like it could have been better. But because he had his leg was bad, I didn't want to do it too many times. I wanted to make sure he was safe and sound. So, you know, that scene, but yeah, I look at all my scenes at all, or even films, and I can see it. I'm watching it. I'm like, I know it could be better, but then you think about the set and like what happened on set, and you know, like you did your best to get what you could at the time.
Yeah.
There's always something that pops up. By the way, always treat your cast great. Because, like, on my sets, I made sure everyone was fed, everyone had a place to sleep, I paid everybody, so everyone was happy, but I'm just saying that because, like, a recent film I was on, I'm not going to say the name, I don't want to do too much drama, but a recent shoot I was on this year, a person did not feed anybody, really, he barely fed people, he had any water, snacks, and then he underpaid people, too, which we thought we were getting paid normally, and then I got home, I got paid, like, one third of what I thought I was going to get. Just, you know, there's a lot of shady indie sets. So just if you want to have a working relationship with people, just be nice. Treat them like how you would want to be treated, obviously. Like, make sure they have food, for one. Make sure they have water.
Totally. Because, I mean, it's just, like, there has been, like, times where out here, because I have friends who are drag queens, I have friends who are wrestlers, and they say, yeah, man, sometimes we honestly will do a gig out of town or out of state. And, you know, if we get fed, that is like, you know, the best thing ever. Because it's like, hey, man, you know, as long as we're fed and we have somewhere to stay or crash, that's all we care about. Like, if we get paid, cool. If not, you know, as long as we get the first
two. Do the
two.
Basics, you know, I can't... make sure you take care of them.
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, it's a labor of love. And they're, I mean, it's a team effort, you know, and it's just one of those things where, you know, I mean, there's word of mouth and there's just like, hey, you know, if you're like this, I don't want to work with you again. You know, I'll do this now. But it's just one of those things where it's like, once that burn is burned, that's pretty much it.
Word of mouth, though, like, I got to say something about that. Apparently, a lot of people that worked with me, here's the thing about word of mouth. Recently, I've been talking to other actors I want to work with, and they know about me because they're friends with the people I worked with already, and they said great things about me. So, like, these actors don't know me, and they're already wanting to work with me. So, word of mouth, if you treat people great, the grapevine will go, you know, do its thing, and people will know, like, oh, wow, he's actually a good person. Let's work with him, even though they don't know who you are. So,
yeah.
Which I'm really happy about.
Yeah, because, I mean, from what I gathered is that you know, there was times where, you know, you would say, hey, here's the schedule. Hey, here's what we're doing. And you was very professional. You were very confident. You were very on top of things. And that's what I loved working with you, was that it was never any doubt. It was never, well, do you think I should do this? Or, you know, it was never like second guessing yourself. And that was really great. And when I saw the final product, I was like, even when I saw the bootleg, like, you showed, because I remember there was a time you showed me the bootleg, hey, this is what I'm working on so far.
Oh, yeah, before the last scene was shot.
Yeah, and I was just like, this is really fucking good. And then you were like, well, it still needs work. And it was just more, like, technical stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And when I saw the final product, I was like, this is even better. So it was just one of those things where, you know, you put a lot of love and care into your work, and you put a lot of love and care into your actors and actresses, because they did a really great job, and, you know, it was just, you know, there's a lot of chemistry where you felt, it felt very natural, like,
especially
all the actors.
Especially Alice and Jason.
Those two, I just want to hug Allison, like, oh my, like, she killed it, and, Like, if there was an award ceremony, I was like, yeah, she deserves a nomination, you know, for something. Because
Most definitely.
I mean, her and Jason were just like, you know, it's just, it was almost like lightning in a bottle for those two, and they killed it. And it was almost like their acting was almost to the point where you didn't have to give them a script. It was just like, hey, here's a scenario. Here's your feelings. Boom. Action.
Do it.
You know, yeah, that's how it felt. And it felt really natural with them. And I think that was really awesome. And, you know, it just, you know, I can't wait to see Scarlett. I can't wait to see other work because, you know, one of the cool things was that when it comes to, like, independent filmmakers, they always have the Kickstarters, they have the Indiegogo, whatever. And there's a lot of benefits. I remember when I signed up, I did the associate producer, and you're like, oh, hey, here's the perks you're going to get. And I completely forgot about them. I was like, okay, cool, I'm going to probably get this one. Like, I'm only going to copy the movie of my credit. Cool. But I remember it was just, like, really cool. You know, everything came all in a box, and I couldn't wait to open it. And I got a copy of the script. I got the collar for the shirt. I got some artwork. Yeah. And it's so beneficial to help out, you know, filmmakers when they do these campaigns, because it's like, you know, you're getting the prompts, you're getting this, and it's just, your money is actually going to the work. So it's not like, hey, you spent $250. Yeah. Yeah, and it's not like, hey, you spent $250, you get your name credit. Cool. Thanks. It's more like, hey, here's, you know, all this cool stuff. And it's just so cool. Like, I'm just so grateful to, like, have work on it. And I'm so grateful to have pieces of it on my shelf next to my movies, you know, to forever go by. And I know we spoke about Joe Meredith's store, but is there anything you'd like to plug? I know you have a store that you would like to, if you'd like to plug right now.
Yeah, mine is samuelvenisiart.storeenvy.com. That's where I am selling Violet at the moment. There's only 300 copies, but there's some signed ones. And I still have the Violet limited bundle. And whatever, there's 10 of them. That's where you get the signed, like, 8 autographed copies. There's not many of them left. I wanted to say that to you. You got one of the very limited signed. There's like 50 of them only.
Yeah.
So that's really cool. And that's what I was waiting the most for, was those 8 autographs. But yeah, the money raised from the Violet bundles, it comes with the screenplay, the 8 autograph copy, and just a lot of shit. The money from that is going to go to Scarlett. So if you want to help out early, that's the way you can do it. I took down the Scarlett associate producer and just the producer credits, because I didn't want to have them up. Because I know some people already said they'd give me money, but like, because the coronavirus is going on, I'm not taking money from producer credits right now, because I want to make sure people are taking care of themselves with their food and just the situation they're in now. Because like, I'm gonna do Scarlett, like, we're going to start at the end of the year and then hopefully shoot it like May or something, like around May of next year. So like, I'm just going to, like, once COVID-19 is over with ish, like in 6 months, that's when I'm going to ask for like money.
Yeah. You know?
When everyone's in a better situation, when I'm able to like actually make the movie. So,
And I think this will help more, because it's just like, you know, because now we have time, so they can see the movies, they can see your work, and like, okay, well, this is what he did with this. I want to help.
And I know Scarlett, for me, I could have made Scarlett first, because it's the cheapest, it doesn't have as many locations, yada, yada, yada. Like, I could easily have done Scarlett first, but I did Violet first, because it was more personal to me. It was a story, because I think I've told this before, that, like, I knew a girl who I fell in love with, and then she got raped and stuff. And I try to help her through it and stuff, but like, that really got to me. And for me to get over things or get past things, I have to write about it. Yeah. So like, for me, my first film had to be something very personal to me. So that's what Violet's about, kind of. And that's why I could have done Violet second, because it is the bigger project. There's so many locations, so many actors. But I decided it's the first project, and Scarlett, I know Scarlet is probably more of the that one. Scarlet feels more of like a real film to me.
Yeah,
because it's more fictional. Like Violet's kind of like personal, whereas Scarlet is more fiction. But oh my god, I am so happy with Scarlet. I think Scarlet's gonna be like 10 times better than Violet. Yeah. Not to say like, oh, Violet sucks. No, I like Violet.
Yeah. But
I just like, I'm very happy with how the script for Scarlet is, and I just want to do it. I just want to do it so bad. Like, there's some imagery in that I've never done before. I bought a green screen recently back for it. There's a lot of little weird things that's going to be in the movie, and nice. I got some, like, I have the entire cast and crew already set. Like, every little piece, the locations are secured. I'm ready to do it. Like, I have the entire film in my head. I just need to fucking get people here and shoot. So
yeah,
that's really all I'm at the moment.
And you know what? You know, I can't wait for it. And when it comes out, or when you're working on it, you know, I want you back as a guest. We can talk about it, or we can give us little tidbits. You know, because I know we don't want to spoil the movie, but you know, we'll talk about it. And I'm really grateful to have you as my first guest. I'm really grateful to have you. To work with you on Violet, and I'll be working with you again on Scarlet when I get the chance to. Because when this is over, I mean, everyone is just gonna fucking, like, we are gonna, like, you know, kick it into high gear and just, you know, we're gonna have so much artwork, we're gonna have so much fucking, I mean, it's just gonna, I mean, we're gonna, like, just redo 2020 and just, like, kick ass with everything going on. I can't wait. For those of you who didn't get a chance to get the store, you know, we'll post a link so that you can check it out, because like I said, buy the work, you know, check it out. It's really worth it. And it's, I'm not saying that because I worked on it. I'm saying because it's really fucking good. So when Scarlet comes out, it's going to be just way more interesting, and it's going to be, you know, way more powerful.
So, oh, can I say one thing?
Yes.
So with Violet, I bought every outfit for Violet.
Yeah.
Because that was a big thing for me, was like, she's the main actor. She's the main actress. So, like, I had to make sure she had a different outfit. So, like, there was, like, 12 or 13 outfits I bought. And, like, I had to make sure, like, I changed them up and stuff. And that was very important to me.
Yeah.
I let Alice have all the clothes afterwards. Like, I took, like, the flannel and stuff. But she has all the outfits. But the money that's raised with the Violet bundle... I'm still buying Scarlet wardrobe. I have a few pieces of clothing already, and I have a lot of stuff actually already bought for Scarlet. But there's a few little things that I would like to get. So after the bundles are gone, hopefully that covers all the wardrobe and just like props.
Yeah.
And so that's what the thing is for that. I have a plan. It's not going to be as crazy as Violet, because like, oh my god, clothing just for one actor was a lot of money.
Yeah.
So. Because I have, you know, I have a nice, like, I know what I want, and for example, with cast and stuff, I had people ask me if they could be involved in some way when I was doing Violet, and I'm like, sorry, I already have it casted, and then they're like, what about your next project? And I'm like, sorry, I already have it casted, because, like, I have a vision, and I don't want to, like, I don't want to change it or tweak it or add, I know some people, they see a person who's interested in them, so they completely change their script or add a character to fit them in.
Yeah.
And I'm not that person. Like, I have a story and I don't want to change it. Like, I've had some big people message me recently.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say who, because I don't want to throw them under the bus or anything, but like, I've had some really big people that, like, I guess people would dream to work with them, but I just don't have any roles for them.
Yeah. That's one of my favorite, like, before we go, but that's one of my favorite jokes was from Kevin Smith. He did a lecture, and he said, yeah, Ben Affleck's a great guy, but working with him, he wanted to improvise a lot of lines.
I remember that.
And
the
he goes,
baseball
I
bad
hate...
thing?
Yeah, and he goes, I hate improvised lines. And I told Ben once, I was like, hey, you know what? Why don't you get your own little improvised lines, put them in the script, and make your own movie? Lo and behold, he did, and he won an Oscar, so I guess he knows a little bit more than me. Yeah. So it's just, it's really funny, but I mean, that's really awesome, and I'm really glad to hear that. Like I said, I'm glad you're my first guest. I can't wait to have you back again. You know, we gotta talk again.
Definitely, man.
Scarlet, or just shooting the bull again, or whatever the case may be, we definitely gotta talk again. But I'd like to thank my guest, Samuel Vecini. Oh
my god, those are great sound effects.
Yeah, that's my... for being my first guest, this has been the Jay Alexis Show, and thank you for listening.